Wonderful. Yeah, so we'll just give everyone a bit of time to get on. I'm really happy to be with you. I'm back at home base, back at Bhaktivedanta Manor, which has been my home for the last 20 years. Well, it's all of our homes. It's an eternal place. And so I'm back here. I'm in the top floor of the building. For those of you who have never been, Bhaktivedanta Manor has a top floor. And in the top floor, that's where all the monks live. And I'm in the room right at the end. So it's the quietest room in probably a very noisy place, because there's 30 monks living up here. But it's amazing to be here. The Bhaktivedanta Manor, for those of you on the call who have never been, is a real hub of spirituality. Every inch of this building is saturated with spiritual energy and spiritual inspiration. So if you've never been, please do come. And welcome to all of you who are joining. Yogi Sharma, Raj, Sarabi Kunj, nice to see you all. And what else am I doing? I'm preparing to go to India. So yes, I've booked a ticket. Of course, they say you can't book a ticket to Vrindavan. You need a higher blessing to reach that very spiritual, transcendent, holy place. But I have booked the ticket, and if all goes well, I'll be going there next week. Maybe I'll see some of you there. And if I don't see you there, then definitely we'll be keeping in touch. I'll try to send you some messages from Vrindavan, sharing some of my inspirations. Yeah, welcome. Thank you everyone for coming. Shushma, Makwana, Sanj Gohil, nice to see you all. Thank you. All right, so today we'll be discussing habits and five things that I try to do every single day. And what I'm going to try to do today is I'm not going to give you the five habits that probably all of you know we should be doing. There are things in spirituality that we're taught about all the time that, you know, you need to do. For example, getting up early or eating healthy or like things like that. But what I'm going to share with you today, or try to share with you, is habits that have developed in my life without me even thinking about it. They kind of just happen quite naturally. And I think those habits are quite very powerful. There's a lot to learn from that. And these are five things that I just naturally began doing in my life and continue to do practically every single day. And these five things, whenever I do them, I just find that the day is beautiful. I always exit that day thinking I really got something out of it. So I'm going to try and share those five with you today. And maybe while I'm speaking, you can share some of the things that you guys do, or you can post your questions. And I know some of you did put your questions on the chat, so on the comments of the post. So I'll try and address some of those as well. So thank you. Thank you all of you for joining. Mahima, Mino, Krishna Berlin. I'll be in Vrindavan at least for a month, and then we'll see how it goes from there. What to say? We have a plan, but we shouldn't have an expectation, right? We talked about that last week. All right, before we begin, let me just say some prayers as we wait for a few more to join. And welcome to everyone. Om Agyanatimirandhasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Mukham Karoti Vachalam Pangam Langhayate Girim Yat Kripa Tamaham Vande Shri Gurum Dinatarinam Paramananda Madhavam Shri Chaitanya Ishwaram Vanchakalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Thank you so much. Yeah, there's appreciate you all joining. And so, yeah, today we're talking about five habits, five things that I've just, I think I just began doing and they became habits. And I'll share, try to share that with you. So I'm not going to speak too long. I'm going to speak like 10, 15 minutes. I'm going to shoot through them and then we'll have a bit of interaction. And you know me, I always like to summarize everything. So here are my five things summarized. Five things that I have ended up doing practically every single day that you may want to also consider. Maybe all of you are already doing many of these things, but I think they're transformational. And here goes. Singing, praying, discussing, grounding, and the last one I've actually forgotten, reflecting. Yeah, singing, praying, discussing, grounding, reflecting. These five things I practically do every single day, and I'll share with you a little bit about them. The first thing, singing. Of course, we sing every day. We sing in a group. We sing, we wake up very early. We're monks, you know, here at the temple. So our days begin with singing, but a very specific type of singing. One thing I've begun doing in my life, and I practically do it every single day, is I sing alone. I sing alone for Krishna. I sing alone in solitude, loud, where nobody's watching, where nobody's listening, where nobody else, there's no audience, there's no one to impress or no one to be inhibited by, where you can just share your heart. So I want you to think about doing that every single day. Just sing alone. Just sing for Krishna or sing for God or sing your heart out to whoever you feel you want to sing to, but just sing alone without an audience. You know what inspired me to do this? I once heard the story of Tanzen. Tanzen was a great singer, the court singer of Akbar in ancient India. And Tanzen was an incredible singer. Like just like the most melodious, heart-touching, heart-melting melodies would emanate from Tanzen's mouth. And Akbar was incredibly impressed by him. But Akbar, one day he came to Tanzen and he said, "You're such an amazing singer. But you know, everyone learned from someone else. And if you're such an incredible singer, then the one who taught you, the person, your guru, that person must be an even greater singer. So if you melt my heart like this, your guru, whoever taught you, they'll probably melt my whole existence. So I want to hear, who did you learn from? And I want to hear them sing." Tanzen began to smile, looked at Akbar and said, "The person who taught me to sing is Haridas. But Haridas, you will not be able to hear him sing because Haridas is like a cuckoo. A cuckoo doesn't sing for an audience. A cuckoo just sings when the sun rises. A cuckoo sings in solitude. A cuckoo sings in the midst of nature. A cuckoo doesn't sing for anything or for any purpose, but simply as a cycle of life, as an outpouring of its heart. And the more you ask a cuckoo to sing, the less it will sing. So if you ever go to Haridas and ask him to sing, he will not sing for you." Akbar said, I need to hear Haridas sing. Tanzen said, "The only way you can do it is if you somehow sneak to Vrindavan and you go to the banks of the Yamuna. Because there at 3 o'clock in the morning, when the sun is rising, the most auspicious time of the day, at that time, maybe if you're lucky, you'll spot Haridas on the banks of the Jamuna in complete solitude singing his heart out for the divine. And so Akbar and Tansen went there, they hid themselves, they arrived at the banks of the Yamuna at 2 o'clock in the morning. And sure enough, at 3 o'clock, Haridas arrived. And Haridas sat there, and then he began singing with no one watching, with no audience, just singing. And as he began singing, Akbar just melted and he said, Tansen, you are right. The way he sings, the way it touches my heart. No one has touched my heart like this, not even you. And then Akbar looked at Tansen and he said, what's the difference between you and him? Why does he sing so sweetly that it even eclipses you? And you know what Tansen said? Because I sing for a king, but he sings for God. He sings his heart out, not for any other purpose than to reach God. And in this way, when I heard that story, I got so inspired that yes, we should just sing. And someone may think, I'm not a good singer. There's another song, a story of Mirabai, who's a great lady saint, and she would go around India singing, and she said, sing, sing. And then one person said, I'm not good at raga, I'm not good at melody. And Mirabai said to that person, you don't need raga, you need anurag. Anurag means emotion in your heart. You don't need the melody of a voice, you need the emotion of the heart. And when you do that, and when you just sing, it's very, very beautiful. So I found that when I do that for 5, 10, 15 minutes every day, I just sing alone for the object of my love or the person I'm trying to direct my love towards. It's very, very beautiful. So try it and just lock your door, go away from everyone and everything and just sing for 5 minutes every day and see how that changes your life. So one thing you can try, singing. The second thing that somehow I ended up doing every single day in my life was what I thought over time is that I had many thoughts in my mind. But then when I started reading the scriptures, what I found out is that the saints and sages would be able to capture my mind, capture my aspirations, capture the state of my own consciousness in words better than me myself. And so what I started doing, I'll show you here, I started creating a book like this. So what I'd have is I have this, and then if you can see here on the screen, it's a book of daily prayers. And so what I started doing is writing down all these beautiful prayers that the saints and sages over the ages have penned through their beautiful realizations. And what I do every single day is spend some time reciting some of these prayers. I don't go through them mechanically, but what I do sometimes is just pick one prayer or two prayers. And I sing it in Sanskrit, even though I'm not a good singer. And I deeply meditate on it. So you take some time, you take one. Okay, let me share one prayer with you. And I say it sometimes multiple times and just deeply meditate on it. So here I'll share with you one of the prayers in my daily book of prayers. Varshati sma yatha kaman parjanya iva tarpayan samudra iva durbodha satvena chalaradiva. Translation. Just as rainfall satisfies everyone's desires, Maharaj Prithu used to satisfy everyone. He was like the sea in that no one could understand his depths. And he was like Meru, the king of hills, in the fixity of his purpose. So I really like this prayer. Just see, Varshati Sma Yatha Kaman. The first thing is we pray to be selfless like the rain. The rain showers everywhere. It doesn't make any discrimination. In the same way, a selfless person just extends themselves to everyone and everything without any calculative mentality. That's such a beautiful meditation. Not just that, Prithu wasn't just selfless like the rain, but Prithu was Samudra Iva Durabodha. He was deep like the sea, the ocean, so oceanic in his consciousness, so deep, so thoughtful, so profound, so introspective. That was Prithu. And not just that, Satvena Chalara Diva. He was like a mountain in his fixity of purpose. So when he had his mind fixed on something, nothing could budge it. He was just that focused, that fixed, that determined, that perseverant. So sometimes on a day, I would just pick a prayer like this and say it many, many times. Varshati sma yatha kaman parjanya iva tarpayan. Samudra iva durbodha satvena chalara diva. And you know, like when you keep on saying something again and again, it's like the scriptures say, it's like rubbing sandalwood. And when you rub sandalwood, the scent gets stronger and stronger and stronger. So in the same way, when you keep reciting something and absorbing and immersing your consciousness in it, it gets deeper and deeper and deeper. So, second habit, praying. Find some prayers that encapsulate your heart, your mind, and just keep reciting them. It's beautiful. I love to do this. When I first joined, I wasn't living in this room. I was living in the room just next to this one. And every day I would wake up at 3 o'clock and I'd be ready by 3:20, because in the Brahmacharya ashram, you learn how to get ready in 20 minutes. And 3:20 to 4:20, 1 hour in the morning, I probably did it for about 2 years every single day. I just would recite verses. And I tell you, it's so beautiful. It's Sanskrit, the sentiments, the realization. It's so powerful. So like, we've got all these books with all these thousands of verses, and just find your jewels, find the ones which touch your heart, and just get a book and just put them all in there. And every day, just recite one of them and just go deeper and deeper and deeper. It's very, very beautiful. So second habit, praying. Third habit, thank you. Thank you for your love. Thank you everyone for coming on. Nice to see you, Radhika, Prabhu. Lalita Saki, nice to see you. Tiku, nice to see you. Shesha, my old friend, my old roommate, is also here. Thank you. Number three. Discussing. You know, my kind of mission statement in life is to share wisdom that breathes. And what I try to do every single day is share wisdom with someone, discuss wisdom with someone. It could be someone that has no connection to this tradition. It could be someone that's been practicing this tradition for 50 years. It could be someone who I just grew up with in my spiritual journey and someone who's a very good friend of mine. But not a day should go by where we don't discuss wisdom. They say small minds discuss people. Average minds discuss events. But great minds discuss wisdom. And so discuss wisdom and share your thoughts, share your feelings and hear from others. And through discussion, not a day should go by where you don't discuss some wisdom with others. I know some monks who, when they call me, before we get into a conversation about anything practical, the first thing they say is, let me share a bit of wisdom with you. And that's so nice, because there's so much to discuss in life. There's so many problems, issues, and the cost of living and what have you, all the different things. So many things to talk about people, so many things to talk about events of the world. But maybe we could also discuss some wisdom, because that's what great minds do. So don't let a day go by where you don't discuss wisdom. And well, that's why here I am. I'm on social media, I'm on a blog, I'm out there and wherever I can, because I try to find as many forums where I can discuss wisdom. Because you know what I want to share with you? When you share wisdom, wisdom expands. When you share and discuss and hear and assimilate wisdom, wisdom expands. So don't let a day go by where you don't discuss wisdom. So this is the third habit, discussing. The fourth habit I want to share with you. Thank you, so many of you are joining. It's nice to see your old friends. Sanatani, I got your question about procrastination, so we'll try and do something with that. And Jason is asking, where do I find these Vedic prayers? Yeah, I'll share with you some tips on that. We have many books, and you know those books, but I can share you some good tips of where to go and where to look. Fourth habit that you have to do every single day, grounding yourself. What do I mean by that? You know, once I went to Vrindavan, one of the first times I went to Vrindavan, and one of the things that blew my mind was these ascetics who live in Vrindavan. And what they do is their daily practice is to bow down. They call it in Sanskrit, dandavat. Dandavat literally means to fall down like a stick. So literally what they do is they bow down, falling down like a stick. Not once, not twice, not three times, sometimes 2,000, 3,000, 4,000 times every single day, just continually bowing down. And I thought, wow, this is very grounding. I mean, they're literally hitting the ground thousands of times. And there are many meanings to this, but one of the meanings is that it's a very, very powerful thing to do, because when you hit the ground, that symbolically means that you're humbling yourself. And you know, if you want to develop love, first there must be humility. There must be a softness of heart. There must be a complete freedom from pretension. There must be a complete simplicity and sincerity, a deep purity. And the basis of all of that is humility. Humility is the soil in which all spiritual jewels grow. One of our great teachers in Vrindavan, once he saw that sugarcane machine. You know those sugarcane machines where they put it through and it turns the sugarcane into juice? It's a big wheel. And he penned a beautiful prayer. He said, may the hard, crushing wheel of life extract some humility from my offense-hardened heart, and may the nectar of that humility give rise to pure divine love. So that was such a nice prayer. So my fourth habit, which I try to do every single day, is I try to do something grounding. I try to do something which is humbling. We're lucky here in the temple. When you live communally, you get the opportunity to do very humbling services. So it doesn't matter who you are, everyone cleans the toilet at one point in the week. And that's amazing. You go and you just clean the toilet and you just realize, yes, I'm just a humble servant. I'm just here. People may praise me. People may give me positions. People may put me on a pedestal. But ultimately, I have to become a servant. And so every single day, to try and do something very grounding, to try and do something which really develops your humility, to do something which helps to break away your pride. You see, pride cometh before the fall. So they say, one who's always proud is looking down on others. And while they're looking down on others, they can't look up and see the grace of the divine. So instead of being high and proud and looking down on everything, rather ground yourself in that humility, and then you'll be able to look up and see so many amazing things by divine grace. So every single day, I try to do something grounding, try to do something which helps you to develop that humility. So that's my fourth habit. And my fifth habit is reflecting. And, you know, I've said many times about things I do to reflect, and you've all heard that, many of you, before. But one thing I've developed as a daily habit is something I do before I go to sleep. So before I get into, or when I get into my sleeping bag and I lie down, you know what I do every single night? And I do this every single day without fail, I promise. I rewind to the moment I woke up that very day. And then I go through the day like in half an hour slots. What did I do from there to there, there to there, there to there? And I just get a snapshot of my whole day. It's like my daily routine. I always go back and look at the whole day. And then I think about, yeah. And then I make an effort. I have to admit, sometimes in the process of doing that, I do fall asleep if it's been a really busy day. But sometimes I do get to the end of that reflection and I'm like, wow, what a day. Or, oh, so it was okay. Could have improved here. Or, wow, you know, this happened, or I learned this. Or from today, I learned that tomorrow I have to do this. But I think that's been very amazing for me, to every single day before I go sleep, just close my eyes and rewind and reflect on the whole day. And I think it just, even if you don't make any lessons, or you don't, you know, write anything down from it, or I think just the practice of being mindful of how you've lived every single, that time in your day is the most valuable asset you have. And when you deeply think, how did I spend my time today? I think it helps us to value time in a different way. So that's my fifth habit. So there you have it. Five habits which make every single day beautiful. These are not habits that anyone told me to do. There are other habits that I try to develop, but these are five things that I found spontaneously over the years. I just do every single day without even thinking. And it's really helped me. So just to recap, singing, number one, just sing alone with no audience, with no one, just you, and let your heart out. And if you don't have rag, if you don't have a good voice like me, don't worry. If you have anurag, I don't have anurag either, but anyway, I'm sure you have some anurag. The emotion in the heart is such a beautiful thing. So first thing is sing. Second thing is pray. Find some amazing prayers which encapsulate the state of your mind and say maybe one of them, two of them, but deeply meditate on them. And I want to say, like, try to do it in the Sanskrit or in the, you know, in the actual language, because it's powerful. The sound vibration is powerful. Third thing is discuss. Don't let a day, great minds discuss wisdom. So just when you meet one of your friends, before you get into a whole conversation, just say, hey, look, I want to share with you something. And can you share something with me, some wisdom? And just get into that mood. Fourth one, grounding. Humble. Do something to break the pride. Because pride is always growing in us, even when we don't know. And pride spoils everything. Pride spoils everything. So let us protect against pride by doing something grounding every single day, so that we can, instead of looking down, we can look up and see divine grace. And the fifth and final thing is reflect. Go back and rewind. and honor every part of the day, because time is so valuable, and so many things come from that time. And let us just, even if you're not reflecting to get any lesson, just be mindful about how you've used your time, and the next day you will be more mindful and careful about how you use your time. So there you have it. I did it. I'm just sharing this with you. Thank you so much. Some of you are just putting it on the chat, and I really appreciate that. And KKDRNS is asking, would I be publishing my book of prayers? Could do. That's a good idea. Yeah, I think these are gems. These are beautiful prayers which have touched my heart. And I think at some point I would like to do that. Because I think they may well touch your heart as well. So yeah, definitely I'll try to do that. And yeah, so what I'm going to do is 8:30, and I think we got a little more time coming in. Nandini is saying, I asked Adi what he would like to ask you, and he said he wants to know when I'm going to India so he can ring me and say bye. Yes, I'm going next week. I'd love to speak to Adi. So yeah, tell him to give me a buzz and we'll have a good discussion for sure. That would be nice. Okay, good. All right, so I'm going to just address some of the points that you guys made on the comments. In the meantime, if you have anything else you want to ask, then whack it on the chat. So I'm just looking at my phone here, and I'm just going to try and bring up. These are some of the habits that you guys asked, like, or you felt you needed help with. So, I mean, each one of these that you've mentioned, I got them summarized here. Each one of them could be a session in and of themselves, but let me give you some seeds of thought that may help. So, ironically, Manasi is asking, how do I get rid of the habit of checking my phone every now and again for no reason? And ironically, reading that off a phone. Yeah, we have this habit of picking up our phone constantly. Here's one idea that someone told me recently. Get two phones. Like, what? I thought that's going to double the problem, you may think. What this person does is that they basically have one smartphone and one dumb phone. And what they do is the smartphone has all the WhatsApp and all of that, because you need to, like, nowadays, if you're not on that, you just can't live, you know, like, people want to communicate and all that stuff. But what they do is they keep their smartphone at home. And what they do is they keep their dumb phone with them. And so if anyone needs to contact them in emergency, then they can contact them on the dumb phone. But then what they do is the smartphone's still online, and then when they come home, or, you know, a few times a day, then they just check all of that WhatsApp in one go. And in that way, you can still be kind of in the matrix, but not consumed by the matrix. And try it out. I thought it was a good idea. I'm going to try it when I come back from India. Let's see if it works. I think another important thing with the phone is just set your boundaries. Like, if people get to understand your habits, then they'll respect you for that. Like, if you're known to be the person who just, like, replies after like 2 minutes of, then you know what, people will badger you more than others. Now I'm not, I have to be careful when I say this, because, like, I'm not, you know, suggesting that everyone just doesn't be responsive at all, because that could also go the other way. But you get where I'm coming from. Sometimes the more you respond to messages, the more messages come, and then the more you have to respond, and then it becomes like a spiral. So somewhere you have to set the boundaries. Apparently, they say Napoleon, not that Napoleon is like necessarily like our wisdom teacher in all respects, but in this regard, Napoleon, apparently, when he would get correspondence, he would only look at it after 2 weeks. Because he would say that most things that people write to me about, it gets resolved itself in 2 weeks. And the things that don't get resolved in 2 weeks are the things that really need my attention. And so I'll answer after 2 weeks and answer the things that really need my attention. So that was an interesting take on it. Again, I'm not suggesting that you do this, but it's kind of interesting that sometimes we live in an over-communicated world. So just create your boundaries. But anyway, maybe try that smartphone, dumb phone idea. Apparently, the sales of dumb phones are increasing more and more. More than ever, apparently. I heard that. I don't know if that's true, but I heard that. I wouldn't be surprised. Manasi, I hope that helps. Something you can think about. Neha Shetty is asking, how can I improve the quality of my meditation, my chanting? This could be a whole seminar. Let me share with you one thing. Next week, we have the holy month of Kartik coming up. And you know, what we generally do in Kartik is we try to develop a habit, or we try to do something extra. So you know what happened to me, Neha, 1 year is I thought to myself, I don't have no more time. I don't have any extra time to do anything more. I'm already packed, you know, moment to moment. How am I going to do an extra vow for this whole month? And you know what I ended up doing that month? I said, I'm going to do my 2 hours of meditation, 16 rounds we do on the beads. I think all of you are familiar. We have our beads and we do 16 rounds on these beads. But what I did that year is I didn't make a vow to chant more. But what I did that year is I made a vow that I'm going to chant in one go. I'm going to chant all my 16 rounds in one go, in one sitting, not being disturbed by anyone or anything. And you know, that vow didn't take any extra time. It wasn't a vow of quantity, but it was a vow of quality. And I tell you, that vow really helped me to improve my chanting. So one thing you can try, Neha, I'm just giving you one tip amongst millions that could be there, is sit down and try to chant and do your meditation all in one go. Try it out. Now you may say, no, I can't do that. Life is busy and, you know, this, that. Try to make it a vow for Kartik. Some of you on the call could try it out. There's about 80 of you on the call. Maybe someone will try it. For this month that's about to start, I'm just gonna chant all of my meditative rounds in one go, sitting down with my eyes closed, preferably not sleeping, but meditating deeply. That could be amazing. Try it out. Let me know how it goes. Neha. I hope that helps. Sanatani, she asked this question twice, so I can see it's on her mind. Sanatani asks, how can I get rid of procrastination? Sanatani, as you asked that, when I just read that, I just noticed that my diary is here. See, like, I'm old school. Like, I don't do diaries on phones. I do diaries like the real diaries. My number one tip to get rid of procrastination, Sanatani, get a diary. Because you know what helps get rid of procrastination? Is you need to write down a time when you're going to do something. Right? They say there are 7 days in the week and some day is not one of them. So if someone says, I'm going to do it someday, no. Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, which day? Not someday. And so what I do is I have my diary here. God, I've got to be careful because I'm just like doing this out on social media. Anyway, you can see. So I have my diary here and I write different things. But then what I do is at the beginning of every single week, I do this. I basically put the 7 days here. I put tasks here. And I put like my schedule, my rough schedule for the day. And I put tasks of other things I have to do in between those things. And then that's what I do at the beginning of every week. So basically, I do long-term planning. I do then beginning of the week plan. And shall I tell you what? I hope it doesn't sound like that. I also try to spend 5 minutes at the beginning of every single day planning that day. I'm that kind of person. My mind works like a structure, you know, like everything has to be a structure. So I just find that helps me get rid of procrastination. Just plan it out. There has to be a time when you're going to do everything. And when you know that I got to do this, I'm going to do that, and then I'm going to do that, there's less room for the mind to kind of oscillate around and dodge it. Hope that helps. Okay, what shall I say here? Okay, one of my old friends, who I think is in India at the moment, so he may not be on the call because that would mean it's 1 o'clock in India. And if he is, get to bed. Gurnataraj, my old friend, is saying, how do I get freedom from doubt? Nataraj, what I want to tell you to get freedom from doubt is that we need to shift our mindset. And again, some of you have heard me say this before. In our life, we need to shift our mindset, and instead of constantly being nervous about everything that could go wrong, we need to shift our mindset and start getting excited about everything that could go right. When we doubt, it's because we're getting nervous about what could go wrong. But you know, when we doubt and we don't act, it's as risky as acting. Doubting is as risky as doing. Did you know that? Sometimes we think, I won't do it because we have doubts. And we think doubting it and not doing it is the safe option. Doubting and doing are both as risky as each other. You know, like a few months ago, as you know, as you can see behind me, I accepted or was awarded or was bestowed, whatever you want to say, the renounced order of life. And someone came up to me later and said, but it's such a risk. It's a risk. It's a lifetime vow. It's a risk. And I was like, yeah, it is a risk. I said, taking sannyas is a risk. Not taking sannyas is also a risk. Getting married is a risk. Not getting married is also a risk. Doing something is a risk. Not doing something is also a risk. Everything's a risk. So there's something within us that we think not doing something is always safer than doing something. We have this kind of default mentality somehow that not doing something is always safer than doing something. But not doing the right thing is as risky as doing the wrong thing. Did you notice that? Not doing the right thing is as risky as doing the wrong thing. So we have to also learn to doubt our doubts. And I'm not suggesting that you become kamikaze now and you just like, yeah, there's a voice of reason. Sometimes doubts are there for a reason because they help us to think deeper about something. But if we're constantly jarred by doubts, we can't move forward. They say, you know, when we're hijacked by doubts, it's like trying to drive a car with your foot on the brake pedal. Have you ever tried to drive a car with your foot on the brake pedal? One thing's for sure, you're not going to hit anything. But another thing's for sure, you definitely ain't going to get anywhere. So that's what over-doubting does to you. Anyway, Nataraj, you're a free spirit. You're a man of the heart. So you follow your heart and you get good people to give you some advice along the way, and you'll be flying. You'll be flying, my friend. All right, it's coming to 8:45. I'm going to do one final thing. Someone has asked, and my apologies, I don't have the name of this, but someone has asked about arguments and conflict. And how can we avoid getting into arguments? Oh my goodness, such a good question. I'll end on this question today. People get into arguments today about the smallest thing. There's road rage, there's supermarket rage. You know, they say if you want to get into an argument on Facebook, it's simple. Just write a comment and wait. And, you know, all hell breaks loose, you know. So, but you know, arguments, in arguments you lose so much even when you win. Have you noticed that? In life, generally, when you take up something and you win, you gain a lot. Arguments is that thing, when you lose it, you lose, and when you win it, you also lose. Because when you get into arguments, what happens? You lose relationships. When you get into arguments, you lose your perspective on life. When you get into arguments, you lose your good character. When you get into arguments, you lose your peace of mind. So how do you get free from being in arguments? Again, I do whole sessions on conflict resolution, but let me say one thing to you that I find helpful. Once a man came to his minister and he said, "My wife, she's always complaining. I just want to argue with her." And the minister said, "Go back and listen to every single word she's saying very carefully and don't reply." So he went back and she was, "Oh, you know, complain." He listened to everything. He came back to the minister. He said, "I listened to every word she said and I'm even more angry. I want to really get into an argument with her." And then you know what the minister said? "Now I want you to go back and I want you to listen to everything she's not saying." How do you listen to something that someone's not saying? They're not saying it. You can't hear it. He said, "That's the point. I want you to now go back and learn to hear the unheard. Instead of just hearing her words, try to understand what emotions are behind it. Instead of just hearing her statements, try to understand what frustrations underpin that. Instead of responding to things that she's saying that seem unreasonable, try to understand what her deeper aspirations are behind it." Because when you do that, you get to understand and frame why a person is acting, speaking, responding in a certain way, and then you don't feel that same enmity towards them because you understand them better. So he went back. And he started trying to listen to everything she wasn't saying. And he came back and he said, "You know what? I get her. I understand it. I really kind of understand it, where she's coming from. And even though everything she's saying seems illogical, it seems irrational, it seems impulsive, now I can deeply understand where it's coming from and I have something to frame it within." And then he felt no need to argue with her. So try it out. Next time you feel like you want to get into an argument with someone, try to hear the unheard and try to see the hidden story. Try to, as Tariq Prabhu is saying, read between the lines. And in that, you may hold the key to understanding someone in a much deeper way. And let me finally say one thing to you. Every disagreement doesn't have to be an argument. Please remember this. Every disagreement doesn't have to be an argument. But every disagreement can be an opportunity for me to get an elevated vision of myself, an elevated vision of this other person, and an elevated vision of life. So let us, in a world which is characterized by quarrel, argument, conflict, friction, Let us try to hear the unheard, and let us try to not make every disagreement an argument, but rather use our differences to try to elevate our understanding. And with that, it's 8:50. I had a great time with all of you this evening. Thank you so much. There are about 80 of you on the call. I really, really appreciate you making the time. I know you all are so busy. You're doing so many things in life, and you make the time to come on. You all ask different questions, and I didn't even get to it because time has caught us up. But what can I say? I will try and touch base with all of you guys next Thursday before I leave for the Holy Promised Land. I hope that will happen. If it doesn't happen, then be rest assured I'll be connecting with you from Vrindavan. If you're available, I'll try to send some reflections, and I hope we can stay connected. It's a beautiful time of year coming up. You know, it's this holy month coming. There's so much to explore, so much to discover. Try to do it. Don't let a day go by where there's no singing, where there's no praying, where there's no discussing, where there's no grounding, and where there's no reflecting. Because where these things happen, life becomes amazing. You all are amazing. And I wish you an amazing evening. And I hope we can all connect again soon. Thank you very much. Good night. God bless. May the force be with you. And we'll see you all again very, very soon. All the best. Bye-bye.